been in my heart for the past few days. And I want to start by reading you something that Tim was kind enough to share on Facebook. And it is Psalm 23. And I like this because it breaks down the psalm and each part of it is a promise from God. I want to read that to you to start. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd." That's relationship. "I shall not want." That's supply. "He maketh me to lie down in green pastures." That's rest. "He leadeth me beside the still waters." That's refreshment. "He restoreth my soul." That's healing. "He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness." That's guidance. "For his name's sake." That's purpose. "Yeah, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." That's testing. "I will fear no evil." That's protection. "For thou art with me." That's faithfulness. "Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me." That's discipline. Yes. "Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies." That's hope. "Thou anointest my head with oil." That's consecration. "My cup runneth over." That's abundance. Mm-hmm. "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life." That's blessing. "And I will dwell in the house of the Lord." That's security forever. That's eternity.
Amen.
So as I was thinking about this, you know, the Lord is faithful. He always does what he says he's going to do. And he promises specific things to every one of us, things that he puts in our hearts. He speaks to us. This is what I'm going to do for you. You know, we all know that all the promises in the Bible are for all of us, but there's specific things for our individual lives that he also promises. You know, and the beauty of it is that we don't have to do anything. All we have to do is believe, and we're automatically called his children. You know, it doesn't matter what it's coming, what you have in your past or anything. You know, the Lord can take a crumpled piece of paper and turn it into an origami swan. Yes. You know?
Yes.
And, you know, recently I was having a conversation with someone, a fellow Christian, and because we disagree on something, that person started questioning my Christianity and my faith in Jesus. They said, "I cannot believe that you call yourself a Christian, man, and even stand up in your church and preach when you actually think this way, just because we disagree." I'm sorry, is your name God to judge me? You know? I know that I'm not perfect, but he loves me anyway.
Yes.
So as I was thinking about this, you know, it reminded me of Paul. Acts chapter 9 talks about how when he was on his way to Damascus, Jesus appeared to him and said, "Why are you persecuting me?" And, you know, that's when he became blind. He told him, "Go here and see this person," and all that. And, you know, he was baptized and he received the Holy Spirit and he started preaching. You know, so if you go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, this is one of the, for me, one of the most powerful scriptures that I have read. And I'm going to read to you verses 1 through 11. "Now, I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved. If you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, And he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, and unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. And this is the key verse. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach and so you believe.
Amen.
Paul used to persecute the church of God. Yet, he was chosen.
Yeah.
And he wrote the majority of the New Testament. Mm-hmm. The revelation that he received from the Holy Spirit, the inspiration that he received from God led him to write most of it. Again, he persecuted the church of God.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. We all have a past. And it doesn't matter that we have a past. God calls us all. Romans chapter 1 says, Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures concerning his Son, who was descended from David according to the flesh and was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations. Verse 6, including you who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. That you right there is not specific to anyone. It's to all of us.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter if you are just being born literally, physically, coming out of the womb of your mother, or are about to have your last breath. It doesn't matter when.
Mm-hmm.
We are all called to belong to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So that's my little nugget of wisdom for tonight. We should not be condemned or feel ashamed because we are not defined by our past. We just learn from it. We are defined by what God says. Yes, James.
One of my friends said that Jack asked me that we all sin and fall short of the glory of God.
Yes.
And we all are accountable and nothing to be ashamed of. And it's so true. And a friend that I love to read it into that, you know, God's real. And
continue praying for the youth group, to young ladies that are here tonight, and just want God to reveal His kingdom purposes through them and those that are being called here. Just to have the teachers and have those that will mentor and walk with these young ones growing up in the Lord and being strong in the Lord, that they can be a light to others in their classes and in their homes and stuff.
Amen.
Let's thank the Lord tonight.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, thank you
for
bringing us together here in your name. We know, Lord, that your Spirit is here moving in this room, brooding over every situation that has been presented here. Father, we declare the healing on those that need healing. We know, Lord, that you have all called us healed by your stripes. So we believe, Lord, in the finished work of the cross, and that the healing that has been promised will be manifested in the lives of all of those that it was promised that we believe in your name. Father, we pray for those that are being called to your purpose, whether it's to this church or somewhere else. We pray, Lord, that they hear your calling, that they come to you running, that the revelation that you are trying to bring forth to them, through them, comes through them. And the youth group that has already started in this church world continues to grow, and that the message that is being revealed in here from you is taken outside of those walls and spread around in every corner of this world. Thank you, Father, for your permission. Thank you for your promises. Father, help us focus on you and not in our circumstances. Put our focus on you, Lord, and those promises will manifest. Put our trust in you, Lord. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us together tonight. Your presence is always with us. Your Holy Spirit that is inside of us. Friday, 9/11, we'll have our Eastern Gate House of Prayer. You know, that date has a lot of significance to me, not because I was impacted by the events that took place in New York that day, but I have always had this admiration for firefighters. I think that is, to me, that's the ideal job. If I could have been a firefighter, that's what I would have done. Because not everyone has the bravery to walk into a burning building to get someone out, not knowing if they're going to come out themselves. So we're just going to allow God to move. That's one thing that I love about our house of prayer in this church, is that we don't put any barriers into what God wants to do. And I would not change that for anything.
Amen. Amen. As you were speaking about the firefighter routine, we're called to go into the darkness and rescue those out of the darkness with His light upon us. And it takes faith and believing that we can get this done.
Amen.
What's going on? So let's focus. I thought I had figured out what was going on Friday night a week ago, and then things started changing 2-3 days ago, and everybody talks about pressing in, or pressing through. Well, the veil's been rent.
Yeah.
We don't have to press through a veil.
No.
That's right.
The veil represented the flesh, skin of God. It's in Hebrews 10, I believe it is, and it's already been torn, and we just
All right, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Hallelujah.
Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God.
Hallelujah.
The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of the servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
There it is. So who can I put on the spot? What's your granddaughter's name?
Shaylee.
Would you mind taking the offering for us tonight? Thank you.
But you can't keep it.
Please don't hate me. All right, I'll do you a solid. Tammy, can you say the prayer? The offering? Thank you.
Got the whole world in his hands. Thank you, Brother Tim, for bringing that revelation. I work visually, so and if I'm sitting back there, I got it. I got you covered, man. Yours was one-handed? Was yours one-handed? He was palming it? Yeah. I didn't have one. I could have edited it, but it wouldn't have turned out right. China would have been on its side. Hallelujah. Let's worship the Lord.
Thanks.
Come on, Kylie.
Woo-hoo. Hallelujah. Let's worship
Him.
Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you, Lord. We just bless you tonight and praise you. Thank you, Lord, for watching over us, protecting us, for your provision, Lord, for all that you are. You literally are everything to us, Lord. We bless your name tonight. We magnify you, Lord. Let all of this service bless you, Lord. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise God.
Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you all. Thank you, especially young ladies. We appreciate your being here. And yes, praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I want to thank Roberto and Suzanne for stepping up at short notice and taking care of the Wednesday night and Sunday service last week. Amen. I drove a long ways and for nothing, praise the Lord. My intentions were right, and my brother's really got some major health issues, and he had to cancel his flight at the last minute, and so I just talked to the Lord. I just had time to spend with the Lord, and that's what I did, praise the Lord, and I appreciate his presence. It's a long ride by yourself, praise God, but I was never alone, hallelujah. That's the good news, praise God. He is a good God. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. I'd appreciate you if you'd continue to remember my brother James, Jim, and also my brother David, who was diagnosed with some pre-blood cancer issues. And I talked to his wife the other day. He was gone when I called, but I talked to his wife yesterday, I think it was. And he is doing better, and they can see improvement, and he's only going back to the doctor once a month. He's hoping to get it to once every quarter, and so praise God. God's on the throne, but just appreciate if you remember them when you pray. Amen. Thank the Lord. They're both believers. That's the good news. Amen, and just believe it. God is going to bless them, amen, with healing and wholeness and restoration in every area. Thank the Lord. Amen. All right. Thank you very much. Let's go to Acts chapter 20, and we're going to read verses 24 through 32, Roberto. Acts chapter 20, verses 24 through 32. Thank you, Lord. How many of you know we have an inheritance? Praise the Lord. That inheritance is every one of God's promises.
Amen.
And hallelujah. I want us to literally experience all of those things in this life. That is His intention. That's what He paid for. That's what He purchased. And we have every right and reason to believe that we can experience all of those. Hallelujah. And I know God's desire for us to experience those things has to be off the charts. He's willing to give His life and for us to experience it. So praise God. There's more to this than going to heaven, although that is a huge and wonderful aspect of it. But we have a life to live here that God wants us to experience heaven on earth. So that's why Jesus said if we pray, when we pray, we should pray that His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we know in heaven there's no sickness, there's no disease, there's no broken relationships, everything is whole and abundant, praise God. And so that should be our expectation here in this life, praise the Lord. So, none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. And now, behold, I know that ye all among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God shall see my face no more. Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God which He hath purchased with His own blood. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I ceased not to warn everyone night and day with tears. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. Say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
All right, let's go to Hebrews chapter 6 now, and we'll read verses 13 through 20. Hebrews 6, 13 through 20. Hallelujah, Jesus. For when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely blessing I will bless thee, and multiplying I will multiply thee. And so after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. For men verily swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation is to them an end of all strife. Wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Praise God. Which hope we have is an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, which entereth into that within the veil. Whether the forerunner is for us entered, even Jesus made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Praise God. So God made an oath, God vowed, and part of that oath was for not only for us to be saved, but for us to have an inheritance. And I was thinking about this the other day. I think the only thing, I mean, God, the closest thing that we could come to this in the natural world would be trying to get out of a cell phone contract. Praise the Lord. God has locked us into this thing, and you're not getting out of it because he's made the agreement with himself. Praise the Lord. So if you've ever tried to get out of a cell phone contract, you know what I'm talking about. God is greater than Verizon or AT&T or any of them. Hallelujah. He is great. Praise God. But Paul, talking about this message that he preached for 3 years with tears and so on and so forth, he's talking about to these individuals. But his goal wasn't a better, more cleaned up version of who they were. Amen? Verse 32, let's go back to that in Acts chapter 20, verse 32. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. So the goal is a reflection of Jesus, or a manifestation, if you will, of Jesus. Amen? Jesus is the healer. He's the deliverer. He's the Savior, praise the Lord. He's all those things to us. Amen? And that's what our life is, to be a reflection of that. We're not supposed to be imitators of Jesus. We're supposed to be a reflection of Jesus as the church. Amen? Acts chapter 26 and verse 18. To open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Amen. So God, he intends on his church to be a reflection of Jesus. That's why he has told us, lay hands on the sick, they recover. That's why we are to do these things. And we need to understand that this isn't something that we somehow get, you know, some tremendous faith all of a sudden and we're able to do this. This is an inheritance.
Right.
And an inheritance, all you've got to do is be born into the right family. Uh-huh. And you get it. Amen? It isn't based on what you do. Your performance is based on who you are.
Exactly.
And in Christ, we are children of God. We have an inheritance, amen, that he is jealous over. I mean, he made an oath with himself to see to it that we get this inheritance, and we should be experiencing it, and we need to understand how it is that we experience this. There are wolves that come in, Paul said earlier in Acts chapter 20, and they try to convince you that you've got to imitate Christ. You've got to be perfect, amen? And you got to imitate his works. And then you may be good enough, and you'll actually see a miracle from time to time. That's not what God said. What God says, these signs follow them that believe. You have an inheritance. Part of your inheritance is you lay hands on the sick and they recover. Part of your inheritance is you speak to things that are not as though they are and they become. Part of your inheritance is you have the divine nature of God, which is the faith of God, which speaks to things that are not as though they are.
Exactly.
Amen. That's our inheritance. Praise God. We don't do spiritual works. We are manifestations of spiritual work. It's God in us. He does the work. That's what Jesus said himself. We are literally the manifestation of what God wants to do in this world.
Yes.
Praise God. Amen. John chapter 15, verse 5. We know this. We've looked at this scripture a lot of times, but it's great to remind ourselves. He is the vine. We are the branches. I'm the vine, you're the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. Which is what I just said. We don't do miracles. We are the manifestation of those miracles. God does the miracles. We are just the branch that gets to expose it, that allows people to see, amen, what God does. Let's look at this then in Mark chapter 16, another familiar scripture, verses 17 and 18, talking about Jesus giving us what part of what this inheritance is. He's going away, amen, and these signs will follow them that believe. In my name, they'll cast out devils. They'll speak with new tongues. They'll take up serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it will not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Praise God. Now, Jesus is telling us this is part of your inheritance. It isn't just about financial blessing. It isn't just about, you know, relationships restored. All that's part of it. But this is a major part of our inheritance. Amen? Christianity is not about imitation. Amen? It's about habitation. It's about being in Christ so that Christ is in us and able then to operate through us, amen, just as he describes it in John 15:5. He's the vine, we're the branches. Jesus says that our only responsibility is to abide. Stay connected.
Yes.
Stay hooked up, amen, to him. The main focus of Satan is to destroy your faith. And he uses anything and everything he can to get you to not believe. This is what Tim has been talking about for weeks, and it's absolutely true. The thing that pleases God is our faith in God or our trust in God. The one thing that Satan knows moves God is us trusting him. So he's got to somehow figure out a way to cause us to doubt God.
Exactly.
Or to look at our circumstances and make them bigger somehow than God is.
Right.
Amen? All right, back to Acts chapter 20 again, if you would, verse 32. Acts 20, verse 32 again. Paul said, "And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up, to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified." All right, now go to chapter 26, if you will, and verse 18. To open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Praise the Lord. Faith in grace.
Yes.
Grace is a person. It's Jesus. And so this is about faith in grace. That is how we actually obtain the inheritance. It's ours. But that's how we appropriate it. It's by putting faith in grace. Not faith in your works, not faith in your faith, not faith in your effort, not faith in your goodness. Faith in grace. Hallelujah. Amen. And that's what has made you righteous. Praise God. That's what is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among the sanctified. It is the power of the Holy Spirit or the Spirit of grace, amen, operating in your life. Praise God. Galatians chapter 2, verses 16 through 21. Thank the Lord. Amen. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. But if, while we seek to be justified by Christ, we ourselves also are found sinners, is therefore Christ the minister of sin? God forbid. For if I build again the thing which I destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. For I, through the law, am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. We are the righteousness of God in Christ. We had to be made righteous in order to become children of God. Amen? That's what gives us our inheritance. That's what gives us access to the promises of God, to the accessing the inheritance of, from God, which is this healing and deliverance and prosperity and all the other things that go along with it. But to frustrate, the very word means keep from attaining a goal or fulfilling a desire or receiving your inheritance. When we frustrate the grace of God, we frustrate the inheritance. We stop the flow of the promises of God, because the promises of God only come one way, by grace. They don't come by us doing things to deserve it any more than my laying hands on the sick isn't a result of me. I mean, I fasted while I was on this trip only because I didn't want to stop. Praise the Lord. But I told the Lord I was fasting, and he knows my heart. So, but nevertheless, I'm saying my fasting doesn't give me greater access to the inheritance. It doesn't make me more powerful. It might make me more aware of God's presence and more sensitive to what God's trying to do, but it doesn't change me in terms of what how God sees me. And likewise, long praying and all of that. Nothing wrong with any of it. I'm not saying we shouldn't. I'm just saying that those things are not what move God to release the inheritance. The inheritance is given to us by grace. Our ability to lay hands on the sick simply comes because we are children of God, heirs and joint heirs with Christ. We will do greater works than Jesus if we operate under the same principles that Jesus operated under, that it's God working through us.
Exactly.
Amen. It ought to just be natural for us. We still have a tendency, right? I'll just speak for myself. Still have a tendency to want to see immediate manifestation. I mean, that's human. But the truth is, we ought to just be praying and just go on.
Yeah.
Just, it's done, right? He said it. All I'm doing, I'm just releasing what God has already accomplished, what God has already done. We just should pray for the sick.
Amen.
And the more sick we pray for, the more sick we ought to expect to be seen healed.
Exactly.
Amen? Somebody's got an issue in their life, we ought to pray for them and believe God, amen, for whatever it is that their need is. We just pray. We're just the branch. The vine has already done everything to produce the manifestation. He's just looking for somebody to be that manifestation. That's us. Praise the Lord. That's what we're called to do. Amen. The wolves that Paul talks about, even among ourselves, even among believers now, are people that rise up speaking perverse things to draw away disciples. Draw them away from what? From what Paul preached, the grace of God.
Sure.
It's simple enough. It's in his own writing, in his own words, amen, telling us that we should be imitators of Christ rather than reflectors of Christ.
Right.
Telling you, God's not going, you're not getting anything from God until you get your act together, until you are perfect in every way,
yeah.
Every T crossed, every I dotted, amen. Let's look at this. John chapter 10, verses 6 through 14. This parable spake Jesus unto them, but they understood not what things they were which he spake unto them. Then said Jesus unto them again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers. Now, I want you to get the context of this, because we usually rush right to the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, right? But actually, the whole book of John is about this. All that ever came up before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and to destroy. I'm come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. He that is a hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming, and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf catcheth them and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd and know my sheep and am known of mine. That's relationship. It's not about keeping rules. It's about relationship. And the truth of the matter is, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He comes to rob us of relationship.
Yes, he does.
And to get us to focus on religion.
Yes.
And the reality is, the thief isn't the devil per se. The thief is religion. The devil just uses it.
Right.
Amen? How? To get us away from the relationship and into performance. Amen? Look at Isaiah chapter 42 and verse 22 through 23. 22 and 23. Isaiah 42. Now this is prophetic. Isaiah is a prophetic writer, but he's prophesying about the coming of the Lord. And this is, he says, but this is a people. Now he's talking about religious people here. This is a people robbed and spoiled. They are all of them snared in holes. They are hid in prison houses. They are for a prey, and none delivereth for a spoil, and none saith restore. Who among you will give ear to this? Who will hearken and hear for the time to come? He says, they've been robbed. Right? They've been taken advantage of. They've been held captive. They're locked up. They're in holes. They're hid in prison houses, and they're like a prey for this roaring lion who's going around seeking whom he may devour. They've, religion, and I'm not, you know, I'm not against every religion, you know what I'm saying? If they're preaching Jesus and, you know, that we're saved by grace, then, you know, we can agree. We can, I mean, there's always going to be differences. But I'm saying there are a lot of places, a lot of individuals and a lot of groups that are preaching this law, this rule-keeping that separates us from God, that binds us up and keeps us from establishing the relationship and therefore hindering us from actually being able to operate as heirs and joint heirs with Christ. Actually seeing what God wants to see manifested in his branches, amen, is being cut off and robbed, amen, between the root and the branch. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. All right, Acts, back again, Acts chapter 20, verse 32. Now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. So again, you can't manufacture it. No matter what you do, you're not going to make it happen. Amen? You can't manufacture it. Your inheritance, your healing of the sick, your raising of the dead, your casting out demons is not something you can do. Amen? It's God who, by the word of his grace, is able to build you up and give you the inheritance so that you can do what God has declared you're to do. It isn't you doing it. Amen. It's God, through the word of grace, that builds you up, gives you confidence to trust God that he will do whatever he has said he will do, because it isn't based on you. It's based on him. It's based on his goodness, on his faithfulness, on his loyalty, on his righteousness, on his holiness. Amen? Hallelujah. God doesn't say he'll make us capable, but he will do it in us. He doesn't make us.
Sure.
Paul was saying, look, this isn't about you becoming a better you. This is about you becoming a different you. The old you is dead. You are now a new creature in Christ. You are now a child of God. And because of being a child of God, you have a right to this inheritance. But you have to receive the inheritance the same way you received your righteousness.
Yes.
Which is by faith in his grace, in his goodness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Verse 32 again. We'll just wear this section out. Praise the Lord. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up, give you an inheritance among all them that are sanctified. To build you up by grace. Right?
Yeah.
I can do nothing of myself. Jesus said, I can't do anything. But, amen, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, who builds me up by his grace.
Yes.
There's nothing that I can't do by the grace of God.
Amen.
There's nothing I can do on my own.
That's right.
But there's nothing I can't do in Christ.
Amen.
That's my inheritance. Amen. That's what I have. Amen. He strengthens me. He builds me up. Praise the Lord. John 15 again, verses 1 through 4 this time. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. Every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you're clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye, except you abide in me. Praise the Lord. He does it in us. Praise God. Those wolves that Paul talked about, they love religion. And they never give up trying to convince us that it's a problem with our lifestyle. Because it isn't faultless, then we aren't acceptable to God, and therefore we're disqualified for the inheritance. But that's not what God said. If you abide in me, if you live, if your residence is in me, how many of you know that we are in Christ and Christ is in us? We are born again. It's that and that alone. Praise the Lord. That's all it takes to be a fruit bearer. In order for you to manifest inheritance, all you have to do is be born again. That's it. You can be a stumble bum. You can flop around and fool. Listen, I saw miracles and my theology was so screwed up. I'm talking about 25, 30 years ago. I'm not saying I wasn't saved. I'm just saying everything surrounding that was just all messed up. It was all about me. It was about how much I fasted. It was about how much I prayed. It was about how much I read the Bible. It was about how good I was to, you know, all week long. It was about, you know, that I didn't have a bad thought, that I didn't, you know.
Sure.
That was it. And it was absolutely wrong, and yet God still blessed me.
Yes.
It wasn't me. It was God. I thought for a little while it might be me, but then I noticed inconsistencies with me that I never see with God.
Exactly.
And that's why I'm saying we have to be taken out of the picture.
Exactly.
We really have to realize that we are crucified, and the life that we now live is not my life, but it's Christ in me that's living this life. And he can do anything, and he can do all things and will if I just allow it, if I just trust him to do what he says he can do. Amen?
Yes.
All right, Colossians chapter 3. Verses 1 through 4. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. To receive inheritance, to manifest it. Let's look at this. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 42 and 43. 1 Corinthians 15, 42 and 43. I think I've just about used every scripture that anybody spoke of here tonight, right? I was really writing fast. No, seriously. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. How many of you know you were buried with Christ? You were crucified. You were buried with Christ, and you were resurrected in Christ.
Amen.
Amen. That's why he says you are a new creature. We've done all the dying we're going to do.
Exactly.
This body may go, but we are not going to die. Our spirit is one with God. It's eternal. It is connected with God. So is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption. We went down corrupt. Hallelujah. But we came up incorrupt. Hallelujah. It is sown in dishonor. We had a lot of dishonorable things probably in our lives. At least I know I did. But it was raised. I was raised in glory. Hallelujah. You are glorious now. Hallelujah in Christ. It is sown in weakness. God knows my weaknesses. But it is raised in power. Everybody ought to say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We have the power of God, amen, resident in us. We might have been weak, but we're no longer weak. Hallelujah. We may have been dishonorable, but we're honorable now. Hallelujah. We may have been corrupt, but we are incorruptible now. Hallelujah. We have been sown, amen, in dishonor and raised in glory. We are the glory. Now, he just said, when Christ appears, we shall appear with him in glory. Why? Because we are already one, amen, in this glorious God, hallelujah, Jesus. We have that right now in this world. As he is, so are we in this present world. Praise God, we ought to be laying hands on everything that's not moving. And if we have to chase them down, have them and lay hands on them. Start speaking the things that are not as though they are. Start releasing the glory of God that is yours by inheritance. Hallelujah. By the grace of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. All right. Hebrews chapter 9, 8 through 15. Man, I'm excited now. I'm going to go pray for somebody. I'm praying for me. Praise God. And there's nothing wrong with that either. You can lay hands on yourself. Chapter 8 through verse, chapter 9, 8 through 15. How's that for confusing? Praise the Lord. I've been talking to the Lord and me, and he knows when I make mistakes, so I don't worry about correcting my grammar when I'm talking to the Lord. The Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect, as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meats and drinks and divers washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of reformation. But Christ, being come a high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. Everybody ought to get that, eternal redemption for us. Hallelujah. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? To quit thinking about what you do or don't do and just realize what he has done. Amen. And for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. Hallelujah. Praise God. Because of what he did, we have it. Amen. Titus chapter 3, 5 through 7. Just got a couple more scriptures here and we'll wrap up. Titus 3, 5 through 7. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. If that, it can't get any clearer, amen? Be justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Amen. Heirs, that means this is what we do, this is who we are. We're not trying to build up to become something. We are the healers in this on this planet. We are the body of Christ. We are the one thing that's going to bring about manifestation.
Yes.
Abiding in him. Amen. Justified by his grace. Praise God. All right. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 13. And we're going to go right through chapter 4, verse 1 through 7. So it's beginning at 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 13. praise the Lord. And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of God, of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory. We already talked about this glory. We were raised in glory, hallelujah, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Chapter 4. Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not. We have this ministry. That's all this inheritance is.
Yes.
Amen. But have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But if our gospel be hid, it's hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us.
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Relax.
Yes.
Hallelujah. He's doing the work. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right, let's wrap up with this one. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 22 and 23, and we'll close with this. Ephesians 1, 22 and 23. And hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be head over all things to the church. Now, look at this. Everything is under Jesus' feet. Poverty, sickness, disease, relational discord, you name it. Just pick anything, and it's under his feet. Praise the Lord. And gave him to be head over all things to the church. Everything under his feet is under our feet. He has left us here to carry out what he's done.
Mm-hmm.
Put all things under his feet, gave him to be the head over everything to the church. Not to everybody, to the church.
Uh-huh.
Amen? Which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Hallelujah. He has given us everything that pertains to life and godliness by those precious promises. We have an inheritance. Amen? And it's to be on top, not beneath. The head and not the tail. Blessed going in, blessed coming out. Amen. The ones who lay the hands on the sick and see them recover. Amen. The ones who speak to those things that are not as though they are. The one who says, light be, and light comes. Because it may have been dark before we got there. They may have been in darkness, but we're taken off the veil. Amen. We've gone through the veil. Jesus has already been through the veil. We already had this connection with God. We are the high priest. That's all the high priest was somebody. That's what Job said. I just wish there was somebody who could touch God and man. And that's us.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We have the connection with God. And this world needs a hand.
Yes.
Amen. They just need somebody to lay hands on them. Somebody to reach out to them and be that conduit.
Amen.
Between God. And that's why we were left here.
Yes.
That's our inheritance. Hallelujah. No limits. We can do all things through Christ.
Yes.
Who strengthens us. Hallelujah. We've been raised in glory. We ought to be living like it. Amen? Give the Lord a hand clap tonight. Praise God. Thank you. The praise be to his glory. Hallelujah. Whom he has been willing to share. You know, it's funny. The scripture says, and I used to read this all the time incorrectly, but, you know, God's not willing to share his glory with another. But he has. He has poured out his glory on us. Amen. Under the old covenant, it was, sorry, you can't see my glory. I'll just let you see the hinder parts, the after effects of what my glory can produce. But to us, he says, you can look it right in the eye, because you are my glory in this earth.
Yes.
And we'll give glory to God throughout eternity according to his grace. Amen. Imagine how upset the devil is. The thing that he went after and got thumped out of heaven because of is something that was freely given to us.
Exactly.
Hallelujah. He can never experience it.
Exactly.
And he sees us and he just sees Jesus. It's like a slap in the face every single time. Another foot coming down on him. Another foot coming down on him. We just need to know it. It's when, if we resist the devil,
yes,
he'll flee. Once he knows we know who we are, he don't want to mess with you. He can't beat you. The only way he can defeat you is to get you into the flesh, into your own works, into your own effort. Amen? As long as we abide in Christ, we are more than conquerors. Amen? Praise the Lord. God bless you. Go in the power of his might. Have a great week. Show me your glory. Hallelujah. I believe that'd be a good thing. Amen. Show the world your glory. Hallelujah. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Have a great rest of the week. Hope to see you back here Sunday. Or Friday. Be even better. Bye, Tim. Bye, Leah. See you later. Thanks again, Suzanne. Appreciate it. Sally said you did a great job. So. James, praise the Lord, buddy.
The stuff is, I've had some irritants. I have some Tesla in my hands that I had to use some drugs and cream and tell me. Oh, look at that.
I gave it to you.
Yeah. Yeah, there's little black bugs that are biting now. I was out trying to dump the pool, and they sting like the dickens. So tiny you can hardly see them. Praise the Lord, James. Cool. You usually hear them, you rarely see them, do we?
Yeah.
Because they're more nocturnal, I think.
You would never see the gray horned owl. You would hear them. Those are big.
They're just because they're usually only out in the nighttime, you know. Yeah.
You can see it a little.
Yeah.
I've been seeing it. That was
God.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
You can see the wings. I mean, it was.
They're neat.
That's crazy.
Love to see them fly. They soar. They're kind of like an eagle the way they fly, too, because they've got a pretty good wingspan compared to most birds.
They're an owl.
Yeah. Oh, she'd be freaked out, wouldn't she? Yeah, exactly.
How is Anthony doing? I mean, he's happy at some of my comments. I've been so...
He's doing good.
I think the talk isn't showing. Once I get my phone back in order, I'll probably Facebook.
Yeah. See you, Cindy. How you doing, girl?
I think
bye, girls. Thanks again for coming. Appreciate your voices.